Hello, and thank you for joining us. I'm Dr. Freda Lewis Hall, former Chief Medical Officer and Executive Vice President at Pfizer, and longstanding and current board member of the Foundation for the National Institutes of Health. It is my distinct pleasure to speak today with the 2020 recipient of the FNIH's Charles A. Sanders MD Partnership Award, Dr. Anthony Fauci. Welcome, Dr. Fauci.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be with you.
So great to have you. You know, you've emerged as a household name and as a national hero in the global fight against COVID-19. But to many of us, especially in the research community, you've been a leader and a hero for decades. You served as the director of the National Institute of Allergy and Infectious Diseases, the NIAID, since 1984. Working on viruses and outbreaks, including HIV/AIDS epidemic, bird flu, H1N1 swine flu, Zika and Ebola. You have seen and done so much in your time. Tell us, what is it about the novel coronavirus that surprises you the most compared to the other outbreaks and diseases that you've helped to lead the nation in combating over the years?
Well, it's quite unique. It really is historic in many respects. It is the most devastating pandemic-like illness that this planet has faced in the last literally 102 years since the 1918 pandemic influenza. I mean, obviously, we've had outbreaks that are of great magnitude. HIV/AIDS, which is the one I've spent a considerable part of my professional career on, is one that when you look at the numbers, the more than 75 million people infected, the over 37 million deaths, the magnitude and the scope of that is extraordinary. But that has taken place over now 39 years in which it's really accumulated a great degree of morbidity and mortality, and we're still dealing with. But that was one that came on slowly and progressed and didn't thrust itself upon the broad general population in the United States, although in some developing countries, it is almost a generalized disease, particularly sub-Saharan Africa. But the difference with COVID-19, I often refer to it as the perfect storm of a pandemic outbreak. It was explosive. It came from an animal-human interface, jumping of species, and it had characteristics, which I have referred to many times in the past, is my worst nightmare. And what I mean by that is not to scare people, but that when you have a pandemic virus that's respiratory borne, that has two characteristics, that when they come together, it can be historic, as this has been historic. And that is a virus that has spectacular efficiency in spreading from human to human. Unlike something like Ebola, which only spreads when you have very direct contact, or Zika, which requires a mosquito vector. This one is person to person in a very efficient way. And the other characteristic is that for certain people, particularly the elderly and those with underlying conditions, it has a considerable degree of morbidity and mortality. When you put those two things together, you have an historic outbreak. And unfortunately for us, that is what we've been living with over the last 6+ months in a very explosive way that right now we're still raging even as we speak.
So it sounds like there are many tools that need to be used in order to tackle this historic pandemic. And we know that two of your superpowers, one of your many superpowers, is collaboration and partnership. Collaboration amongst industry, government agencies, academia is essential when it comes to the research and development of vaccines and therapeutics. And one such collaboration that has emerged in urgent response to the global pandemic is NIH's ACTIVE, Accelerating COVID-19 Therapeutic Interventions and Vaccines, which is coordinated by the FNIH. And you serve on the executive committee of ACTIVE. And I would love to hear from you, your perspective as a leader of ACTIVE, why this type of collaboration is essential from making urgent progress against the COVID-19 pandemic?
I think you used the correct word, essential, because there is really no chance that we would be able to adequately and effectively address this historic outbreak without a very close public-private partnership. We're talking about a combination of public health measures and the scientific development of countermeasures that only a close partnership between the public and the private sector. It's one of those things that the federal government could not possibly do alone, and something, quite frankly, without the science and the public health addition that we bring to it in the federal government, the pharmaceutical companies would not be able to do it alone. So you're dealing with a disease, an outbreak that requires public health as well as fundamental basic and applied science and the extraordinary capabilities of industry. And in fact, what we have done in this public-private partnership has now collaborated in an entire spectrum of collaboration. From one of the vaccine candidates, for example, that was actually developed by NIH scientists, and then in collaboration with industry, have brought it at unprecedented speed from the first awareness of the virus itself to a phase 3 trial, which was entered into on July 27th. That isn't anything that even was imagined to be possible a decade or two or three ago. In addition, for the other companies, which have also promising products, we are collaborating in the sense of making our clinical trial sites available, making a coordination or a harmonization that is happening through Operation Warp Speed, which is fed into by ACTIV, which is really the collaboration between industry and the federal government, and prioritizes in a very transparent way the kinds of things that we want to put government resources in. And it isn't just with vaccines. It's with monoclonal antibodies. It's with direct antivirals. It's with convalescent plasma. It's with hyperimmune globulin. All of those things could not be possible without the collaboration between industry and government, which is coordinated and led by FNIH.
Now, the FNIH has worked very closely with NIAID on a number of programs over the years, from ongoing research collaborations on HIV/AIDS to tuberculosis vaccine and treatment research to bioinformatics in Africa and now ACTIV. What value do you believe the NIH brings to the field of biomedical research around the globe?
Well, I mean, the NIH, as we all know, is the leading, by far leading, funder of basic and clinical biomedical research. And in fact, if you look at the things that occur out of universities in this country or outside of this country, the fingerprints of the NIH's basic science approach is all over that. In fact, there have been studies to show that of the products that come out, be they diagnostics, therapeutics, vaccines, somewhere along the chain of events that went from the initial concept to the actual product, the NIH scientists, either scientists that are NIH scientists or funded by the NIH, one way or the other, have their fingerprints on that. And that's a good thing, because fingerprints on something means that you may have given it a jump start and then partnered with industry. You may have stimulated others to take the ball and run with it. But it's the core fundamental basic science that's at the root of it all. And that's the reason why, even though we do a lot of applied science, the fundamental basic science is the thing that informs everything else that springs out of that, which is the reason why you hear us being so adamant about the importance of the support of basic biomedical research.
And the work with FNIH that facilitates the partnerships and collaborations, how do you see that working now? And do you see any opportunities for future growth in that area?
Well, before we had that, it was really somewhat of a taking a chance whether these types of collaborations work. And it was always almost starting from square one, which took a lot of time and took a lot of effort. When you have the partnership now, as you see between FNIH and the scientific endeavors that we do, it's now a well-oiled machine, which really makes things much, much easier and much more efficient and effective. And as the months and years go by, we get better and better at that interaction. So I think for the future, it's going to be even better than what it is right now.
Now, winning this award signals a commitment to collaboration as a way to advance science, in keeping with the vision of Dr. Charles A. Sanders. And Dr. Sanders is the former chairman of the board of the Foundation of the NIH, which has for nearly 25 years supported the mission of NIH. As a longtime director of NIAID, what does winning the Charles A. Sanders MD Partnership Award mean to you?
Well, it really means a lot. We have an extraordinary team at NIAID, and I feel really privileged to be the leader of that team, but also to be a part of the NIH as a whole, which has, you know, multiple institutes that do absolutely wonderful things. So it's humbling, number one. Number two, it represents the work of a lot of people. But it's particularly meaningful to me for a number of reasons. One, the extraordinary partnership and the productivity that's come out of the interaction between the FNIH and my institute and me personally, but also the name of the award, Sanders, who is a man I admire and has been a hero for so many years to all of us. So I have multiple reasons why this is very meaningful to me. Those are just a few of them.
Given all that you've seen over the years, starting with the research response to HIV/AIDS, how does the response to novel infectious threats differ today? And what has been the most striking, stunning advance in the scientific approach to such response?
Well, the response today is so different. When I look back early on, let's say when I first came to the NIH as a fellow, and I was a scientist here for multiple years before I took over as the director, and I'm still an active scientist. And in fact, about an hour and a half ago, I made rounds on our patients at the NIH Clinical Center. What has changed is the spectacular advance in the technology, particularly the platform technologies of vaccinology. Is just literally a galaxy apart from what it was multiple decades ago, where you could get the sequence without even getting near the virus. You can get the sequence of a virus in a day. You could pull out the gene that codes for the protein that you want to make a response against, and you could stick that into any of a number of platforms. Genetic platforms like mRNA and DNA, viral vectors like VSV and adenovirus, or just the plain old protein that you could make by recombinant DNA technology. And you could go from sequence recognition to a phase three trial in about 6 months. We could not have even imagined in our wildest dreams that we could have done that 10, 15 years ago, but we're doing it now. So to me, that's the biggest advance, is the extraordinary technological advances and our ability to do sequencing, rapid, high throughput, as well as the platform technologies that we do with vaccines and therapeutics, as well as the targeted antiviral and antimicrobial things that we do, again, that we've never been able to do before, utilizing structural biology, utilizing cryo-EMs to identify targets, both of the vaccine and of the drugs. Again, these things were unimaginable years ago.
Now, so much going on, but what do you anticipate as the most exciting future opportunities in your role? And what are you most hopeful about as you look to the future of research?
Well, I mean, research in general will go on long after I'm gone. But the things that I focus on right now, when I took this job and realized the importance of global health, we had HIV, we had malaria, we had tuberculosis, we had neglected tropical diseases, but the three big killers of malaria, TB, and HIV, what I would like to see, hopefully while I'm still here, but if not soon after I leave, would be that we have effective vaccines for all three of those. We have spectacular drugs for HIV, therapeutics. We need a vaccine to put the nail in the coffin of HIV. Tuberculosis is still the leading infectious disease killer in the world. We're having better drugs now, particularly for multiple and extensively drug-resistant tuberculosis. But we still need a good vaccine, although we've made some good strides. Malaria, again, we have very good drugs for malaria. We need a vaccine. We're working on all of those things. I would like to accomplish that, even if it's the first generation of the vaccine for those, and that will get better and better as the years and decades go by. But I'd like to see the first success in all three of those, and something that I feel actually cautiously optimistic that we will get reasonably soon, and that is a safe and effective vaccine for COVID-19, for the SARS coronavirus 2, as well as some meaningful interventions in the therapeutic arena, so that we can lift the veil of this terrible scourge that has really gripped the entire world over the last 6 months. That's what I look forward to. That's what I think about when I go to bed at night, and that's what I wake up thinking about.
Well, Dr. Fauci, I want to thank you again for being with us today, for all of your many contributions, and I want to congratulate you again on such a well-deserved acknowledgement.
Thank you very much. It's my pleasure, and really a great humbling honor that I have. Thank you very much.